Well, Halloween sure is fun, lots of different costumes, but boy, what a lot of zombies these days. I saw zombies in yard decorations way back at the end of September, and there were plenty haunting doorways and Facebook this weekend. For a number of years now, the youth of America have been obsessed with zombies. Not just at Halloween, zombies seem to be all the rage. And in case you don't know, zombies are fictional humans who have died and become reanimated to be the living dead characters found in horror films and pretend frightening stories. A few years ago, our son Robin was a costume participant in a zombie walk, an event where dozens of people dress as zombies and parade through their town. And Robin was not the first in our family to explore zombiedom. Our older son Jordan liked them too. And he surprised me one day while I was in seminary by engaging me in a very intriguing conversation over coffee about how Jesus fit the zombie genre, since he died, was buried, came out of a tomb, and then walked about in a post-dead life. I was stunned by the thought. It had never occurred to me, but I found it hard to argue with him, at least with respect to those similarities. And of course, my own generation has had an interest in undead monsters. Actually, most of us have likely seen such characters growing up. And while Bela Lugosi starred in The White Zombie as far back as 1932, and other zombie films were made back in the day, mostly we earlier generations knew living dead creatures as ghouls and mummies, vampires, or by name, Dracula, Frankenstein. All these brought back to life undead beings like zombies are make-believe stories. They tend to be about the havoc and fear and terror they cause and the efforts by humans to stop. And I suspect that most of us who hear the story of Lazarus at first have some sort of image of a mummy or zombie-like guy in death rags emerging from the tomb. And that's to be expected given the widespread cultural image of the undead. That's where the similarity ends. In today's story of Lazarus, there's not fear or terror, but rather amazement and awe at the miracle of Lazarus getting a second chance at life, real life, not zombie-like existence. There's no sense of fearing by anyone at Lazarus' resuscitation. Concern about how to stop him from living doesn't exist. In fact, it is Lazarus' death that people dread. And that's actually how other Bible stories about people being raised from the dead go. Death is mourned, and second chance at life is rejoiced. There's no monsterness to it. Instead, it's about God creating life out of death. Obviously, in our tradition, Jesus' resurrection is the greatest story of God creating life out of death. Any way we look at it, Jesus' life goes on and on in some respect. Death doled out by an empire man could not stop the life of love lived as God incarnate. It powerfully resonates in human history and many lives still. Jesus' life continues to influence humanity. And in a broad symbolic sense, we could even argue that earthly power's horrible way of death and its dead love are given new life through the risen Christ. And at least for Christians, it's actually through that continuing life of Jesus that we ourselves get new life. One might even say in retrospect that a number of us have left behind a zombie-like life. Death, dead ways of being. Last week we sang Amazing Grace. We're going to sing it again today. It was written by John Newton, a former captain of a slave ship who was once blind to the death to life he was leading and to those that he was causing. And in a moment of conversion, Newton was able to finally see saved him from the death of his truly awful wretchedness and gave him new life. The slave trader in his new life became a minister, him right, seeking justice and loving kindness, walking humbly with God. And you know what? Lots and lots of us come here from troubled places. For some reason, we like to imagine that others live nearly untroubled lives, but most of us, in fact, have had troubled lives. We all have stories. And our stories are often scarier than zombie tales because they are real. They kill our zest for life, maybe even make us dead to life. In many ways. I mentioned before that I was raised in a very troubled home, and I look back now and I realize how very dark, even suicidal, the time it was for me as a young adolescent. And then I felt compelled to go to a neighborhood church. And that church showed me a lot of love and kindness and care. It showed me Jesus. He gave me self-worth beyond what I had ever known before. Jesus did his miracle stuff and raised me from the scary dead-to-life troubled way that I was in. His love resurrected my life. And I went on from there to live. To live fully. And many of us have stories like still somehow living in Jesus' efficacious effects can and does bring us to life in a fully living way. God wants to save us from dead to life living. It's a scriptural theme. And the Bible has more raising from the dead stories besides Lazarus. Christians focus mainly on Jesus' resurrection, but actually there are 8 other stories of individuals being raised beside Jesus, and 1 other story that refers to numerous people being resurrected. Of the 8 individuals who were raised from the dead, 3 of them occur in the Old Testament. Elijah brought back to life a boy, and Elisha, who asked for a double portion of Elijah's anointing, raised the boy while alive. And then Elisha's bones touched another man's corpse in his grave, and it brought that man back to life. In the New Testament, Jesus outdoes Elijah and Elisha by bringing back to life 3 dead people. His friend Lazarus, a young man, and a little girl. And just a side note, the little girl's resurrection is the first female resurrection, and it suggests the equal status that females take on in the Jesus. In his life on earth, we're told Jesus raises more than the prophets of old each did, and he makes sure that one of them is a female. And then upon his death, actually at the moment of his death, Matthew 27 reports that, quote, tombs opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And that after his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and into the holy city and appeared to many. End quote. Jesus' sacrifice leads to many being given new life, and his resurrection on Easter then leads to them being welcomed back to the living. There are 2 more resurrections in the Old Testament. After Jesus ascends to heaven, and Peter raises a woman named Tabitha. Here too, it's important. The first story of a post-Easter resurrection is a female. And later, Paul gave new life to a man. Not one of the numerous raising the dead events in the Bible lead to fearful acting monsters or dread. None of the resurrected in the Bible become ghouls or zombies. They all receive the gift of new life, and then they live it out until they die, rejoining the ordinary circle of life. Except, of course, Jesus, who one way or another lives on and on in history, transforming dead and deadened lives into new, fully lived lives. Jesus lives has been the Easter mantra for 2,000 years. We don't chant or sing, Lazarus lives. But it doesn't mean that the story of Lazarus is not important. Lazarus' story is from the Gospel of John, written long after Jesus lived and died and was experienced as risen. Jesus lives can fairly be said to be John's mantra. That gospel begins by describing Christ as the Word of God being made flesh. And just before Christ raises Lazarus from the dead in chapter 11, he, the Word of God incarnate, says, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will not die." And then only 18 short verses later, the words of Christ prove this quite literally. We're told that Christ said, "Lazarus, come out." And Lazarus comes out, but he's still bound up in funeral cloth. And Christ's next words to his followers are, "Unbind him and let him go." Lazarus is not a zombie, the once dead, now alive. Lazarus is not a threat to anyone. As we heard, the goal is not to stop him. The Word of God commands Lazarus to come out and commands Jesus' followers to set him free. The story, like many we have looked at so far this year, has layers of meaning. It's perfectly all right to think of it as proof of a miracle which proves Jesus is divine. Surely it has long had that as one of its meanings. But it's also okay to think the story's importance is not in recounting an historic event, but as a meaningful story. The top layer most people get is that Christ is powerful and can do miraculous things that even death can't stop. We know that's true in Jesus' own life and death and resurrection story. And here, in our reading today, it's true in someone else's life. And we can actually even hear Jesus' story echoing in the Lazarus story. There is death and mourners, entombed, stones moved, funeral wrappings, even a carrying woman named Mary, a risen body. The meaning seems to be that we too can experience a resurrection. And many believe resurrection is a heavenly thing, and it may very well include that. The story of Lazarus is a very earthbound one. On earth, Jesus brings new life to a man dead to the world. And at the very moment of that new life, Jesus on earth commands his earthly followers to unbind and free the one given new life on earth. Jesus, who is known as Emmanuel, God is with us, aids Lazarus, whose name means God helps. And these meanings sum up the difference between Jesus' Easter resurrection and Lazarus' resuscitation. The Easter event means God is with us. The Lazarus event means God helps. And it struck me as I was working on this sermon how today's lesson is the very opposite of a zombie story. Living dead are given new life. John Dominic Crossan, a preeminent New Testament scholar, turns out seems to agree with me, or at least I sense it. But Dr. Crossan, as you might expect, puts it in a much more academic, non-zombie way. He writes, "For John's gospel, the process of general resurrection is incarnated in the event of Lazarus' resuscitation, a movement from process to event. But I can imagine peasants all over Galilee who would have said with equal intensity that Jesus brought life out of death and would not have been thinking of the heavenly future, but the earthly present. Life out of death is how they would have understood the kingdom of God, in which they began to take back control of their own bodies, their own hopes, and their own destinies." You see, Jesus' death, there is new life. In his resurrection on Easter, there's hope for new life for all whose life is at a dead end, whether troubled by disease or accident, abuses, misdeeds, or wrongs. Whatever has deadened us can be overcome. As I said, we can choose to believe Jesus really raised the dead man back to life, but beyond a miracle, for a long-gone man, is there continuing meaning in this story this morning? I believe it is to remind us that one Jesus' greatest gift was and is taking dull, dead life and making it so vibrant and so new that it feels like being what I like to think of as being unzombied. Easter is a gift. It brings us life. It's a gift that goes on after Jesus' life. Jesus is, in fact, still Emmanuel. God is with us. And we are all of us Lazarus, the one that God helps. For Christians, the ultimate, undeniable truth in the Lazarus story is how Jesus gives to those of us who are in a troubled, dead-end life, new life. And that will always be so, because Jesus lives. And because of that, all of us Lazarus can live.